The last speaker for today is Professor Jack Moehle, former director of the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Center, and my colleague at Berkeley here. He's going to be talking about the application of performance-based earthquake engineering to a class of building structures that are tall, high-rise buildings. And this project, as I mentioned this morning, got a recent award last week from the Structural Engineers Association of California for excellence in structural engineering in the research category. Jack?
Thank you, Steve. So it's really great to be here. It was a long, long trip getting here today. So I'm showing here the cover of a couple documents. One is the Tall Buildings Initiative Guidelines, which we worked on in the PEER program. And then on the right-hand side, I'm showing an image of a document that is just about to be finished in around December or so this year, maybe January next year, by the Applied Technology Council, ATC 58, on next-generation performance-based seismic design guidelines. And I show the two together because they work hand in hand. And also importantly, to recognize that FEMA has put a tremendous effort into a companion parallel effort on performance-based earthquake engineering, but it's built really a lot on what's gone on in the PEER program. The basic tools for calculating the losses, the setup really came out of the PEER program, and they've taken that and moved it further, and it's going to be available for all of us to use very soon. But Steve asked me to talk about the tall buildings issue and how the performance relates, and we'll bring these two together before we're finished today. I need to mention that the Tall Buildings Initiative, as Ross said, all projects take 3 years, and some take even a little bit longer, but this was about a three-year project. We had many partners who contributed in many parts of this, and each one of them required some hand-holding, some more than others. There were many people who participated in this, and if you're sitting in the back of the room, there's no way you can see it. I just want you to see that there were a lot of people who participated, and thanks to all of them, there was a tremendous participation from practicing engineers and academics. An advisory panel, there was a group that looked at performance objectives. There were various technical studies that were done. There was a guideline development team that we tried to balance north to south on the West Coast. And then we did some case studies, which will be a big focus of what I want to talk about today. So thanks to all those folks. The guidelines themselves are sort of the product that came out of the Tall Buildings Initiative, among lots of other little things that we learned, that is intended to be guidance for practicing structural engineers on how to design tall buildings. And it goes through 10 chapters. It does it in about 90 pages, so it's not too difficult to read. It's not the 500 you find in some other reports that come out of PEER. We didn't have enough time to make 500 pages. It has an intro, and it works through the design process. It gives guidance on how the engineer ought to think about the design, organize the calculations, the presentations for peer review panels. It goes through the assessment and then how you should present the results and how peer review ought to be done in a sane way. It's never quite that simple, but this walks you through lots of the different pieces. First chapter says, look out, there's curves ahead. And indeed, in any performance-based design, and maybe especially in a tall building, there are lots of curves. And the curves start right at the beginning. You have to decide what your performance objectives are. You have to be sure that the city's on board, the developer knows what the developer is getting into, and so forth. So chapter one says, okay, these are the things to look out for. And one of the curves, of course, is that you need some training. And not everybody has adequate training for this. So there's more there, but I just want to give a glimpse of what's in it. Seismic performance objectives. We had a group that looked at what were the appropriate performance objectives for tall buildings. And yes, I know these are iconic buildings. They have large populations. Well, not necessarily so. There are some tall buildings around that we would just as soon get rid of. I'm sure you all have your favorites. And many of these buildings don't have such large populations in them. In fact, if you take a 50 or 60 story residential tower and figure just how many people are sleeping there every night, it's not that many. And so their occupancy category isn't anything special. Tall buildings are special in the sense that if you have a lot of cladding fall off, it's dangerous to other buildings. If you have a large residual drift, what are you going to do with the thing? And so those kinds of issues we address. But apart from that, we could not convince stakeholders and others that we worked with that there were any special performance objectives required. And so we really looked at designing these buildings and writing a guideline document that was for occupancy category 2, pretty much ordinary performance objectives, and that's kind of where we aimed this thing. Now, we did tackle the way you do the design in a little different way. Rather than starting out with a life safety check for a 500-year earthquake, we said, no, let's start at the one end, serviceability. That's one of the things we're trying to achieve with the building, something that's serviceable for ordinary earthquakes. And then at the other end, we want the building to be stable for the maximum that might occur to the building. And we, through lots of discussion and analyses, we ended up setting aside the basic objective check that's in the building code. There is no minimum code level strength check in this document. What ends up controlling the strength, for the most part, is the serviceability check. We give some guidance on ground motion selection and scaling. We didn't break a lot of new ground here. There's lots of work going on in this field, and I think there will continue to be for some time to come. But we described what are the salient aspects of ground motions that need to be considered carefully for tall building design, how to deal with scaling and matching, two different approaches that are allowed, and then some of the aspects of conditional mean spectra. There's a lot of discussion about using conditional mean spectra. In a tall building where multiple modes may be influencing the design parameters, you might need to check multiple periods. But there's lots of great work going on in PIER and elsewhere addressing those issues. We gave some guidance. For the service level analysis, first thing to note, the performance goal is, at worst, minor structural damage, the kind of damage that would not require repair in order to get through any future earthquakes. Cosmetic damage is what we're talking about, things you might want to repair only for cosmetic purposes. In the analysis of the building, the intent is that you model everything. So this is a little different from how a traditional building design is done, where you only model the code-complying seismic force-resisting system. All the components ought to be included. The analysis suggests use a linear analysis, 43-year return period, and here's the zinger, 2.5% damping. And this is different from what we've done in the past, but the evidence is that for these taller buildings especially, the apparent damping ratios are not 5%. They're down near 2%, and we ended up at half of 5%. So this typically controls the strength of a building that's designed on the West Coast. It's this service level check. And the strengths on the West Coast come out pretty close to what you would get with the code minimum strengths. There's a various acceptance criteria, but we're really looking for effectively linear response. And there's equations given, not too many, no integrals whatsoever. There are load combinations which are familiar. The demand has to be less than, and the way it was finally adopted, 1.5 times the design strength that's in the current building code. So we didn't want any fancy way of calculating strength, so you do it the way the code says. 1.5 because we know we can anticipate, we can accept a little bit of nonlinear response without having to repair a building. So we compromise to that, and there's a drift limit. For the maximum considered level, there are some performance goals of not collapsing, modest residual drift, and limited potential for the cladding coming off the building. Hate when the cladding comes off. The model, again, you can include all the, you should include all the components. Nonlinear analysis is included. The acceptance criteria, I don't want to get into the detail here. If you're into nonlinear dynamic analysis, you'll love this document. If at 10 to 5, you don't want to get into it. Okay? So, but you have to keep your force and deformation limits within capacities, within limits that you're comfortable with. And there has to be controls on the drifts. And so this is something that's somewhat new in practice. We recommend that the mean of seven runs should have a drift, a residual drift. Excuse me, the mean of seven runs, the maximum, should not go over 3%. No analysis should go over 4.5% because nobody who's even, you know, even the best analysts don't know what's going on out at 4.5% drift ratio. It's just too far. And then there's residual drift limits of 1% as a mean of 7 and 1.5% as the maximum. You don't want to design a building, do calculations that tell you the building's going to be a leaning tower and accept that building. It's just not the right thing to do. So that's something that's a little different. For non-ductile actions in a building, the requirement is that demands be less than expected strengths by a capacity reduction factor. And we recognize in the document that the dispersion that you calculate from 7 earthquake ground motions is unknown in terms of its reliability. It's a number. And so you can't count on that dispersion as a basis for design. So we suggest that as a minimum, you put some other factors on the design quantities that you calculate. But again, you can go in and look inside the document to see. And then there's other guidance on how to organize the calculations, what things to include in your criteria documents, how to run a peer review panel, and so forth. So it's useful guidance for tall buildings and other buildings as well. So if you want this, send me $10 and I'll send it to you. Actually, it's free on the peer website, okay? And I hope you've seen it. We wanted to understand what would happen if you designed buildings by this technique. And I have to admit, it's all done kind of with smoke and mirrors because we didn't actually design and build and subject these earthquakes to real earthquake, these buildings to real earthquakes. We did it by calculation, but we did it as well as we could. We selected a location in downtown Los Angeles. If you know the Superman movies or the series, you know, Superman always flew out of that one building, I think, in downtown Los Angeles, City Hall, famous location. That's where these buildings were put, downtown Los Angeles and City Hall. We picked 3 buildings to look at, a 42-story concrete core wall building, 42-story concrete dual system, a 40-story steel buckling restrained braced frame. So 3 different building configurations. The designs were done by 3 experienced design firms on the West Coast, Magnuson Klemenchik, Simpson, Gumpert & Hager, and Engelkirk down south. So they designed these buildings. We didn't do it. We gave them the specs, and the site and the ground motions were selected by geotechnical engineer with experience in this, and they did the designs. Okay, so we didn't do this in the academy. Each one of these was designed by 3 different methods, so we could get a sense of how would the different codes of design affect what came out the other end. And so we used the International Building Code, except we allowed the buildings to be taller than the height limits that the code might impose. We picked as code B, the Los Angeles Tall Buildings document, and C, we picked the Tall Buildings Initiative, and we said, go ahead and design these buildings 3 times, so we end up with 9 buildings, kind of. Okay, and it's interesting just to take a peek at what happens when you design different buildings by different codes. So the core wall building, just one thing that happened that was different. What we're showing in the different colors on the up the height of the building are the strengths required in the coupling beams of the core wall. And nobody can read the numbers except me, but there's a significant variation in the required strengths of the coupling beams by the different methods. So the buildings are different in character. I should point out also that the Tall Buildings Initiative, because of the 43-year return period motion at 2.5% damping, required more thickness in the shear walls. Ron Hamburger will be here tomorrow as part of the session first thing in the morning to talk about what have some of the experiences been in practice with the Tall Buildings Initiative. And they're finding that the walls are getting thicker and a few other things. So it'll be interesting to see what he has to report. In the dual system, the big change came really with regard to the frame. So a dual system has a core up the middle plus frames around the perimeter. And the columns went from being 36 by 36 inches all the way up the building to being as big as 46 by 46 at the base. What was found in the design process was that the code was resulting in columns that had very small sections and pretty high axial stresses on them. And so as we went into the performance-based designs with the other documents, the columns started getting bigger. And this is going to affect some of the costs later. Building three, the buckling restrained braced frame system, it totally changed from one design to the other. The code-based building was fairly simple in configuration, but the code required these massive columns. It was quite expensive and a lot of, I think, wasted steel. As we got to the LA Tall Buildings, it got very slender and scary, in my opinion. Anyone from LA, I apologize. Then we went to the Tall Buildings Initiative, and the service level design requirement was heavy on this building, and the system completely changed with outriggers. It's a totally different building from the other two. But those were the three designs that came out. We went back to the site. We said, okay, Los Angeles, what kind of seismic environment are we dealing with? Well, it's pretty complicated. We have close in several faults that are capable of 6 to maybe 7. I don't know the magnitudes. I forget the numbers. Farzine, maybe you remember. Is Farzine in the audience? Maybe not. But then more distant, we got the San Andreas fault. And so when we disaggregate the seismic hazard, we find that on the one side, close in, we're affected by a lot of magnitude 6.5 to 7s, it looks like. But there's also a pretty substantial impact coming from the San Andreas, looking at magnitude 7.5 to 8 and so forth at a more distant site. So we selected ground motion records, went through procedures that we've worked on in PEER over many years. And on the left were the response spectra, uniform hazard response spectra for the different return periods we looked at. And by the way, we looked at a 25-year, 43-year, 475-year, and 2475-year return period. And then MCE used to be the maximum credible earthquake, and it changed to the maximum considered or most confusing. I forget which it is. But just to prove that you could get higher than that, we went over the top. And we picked a 4,975-year return period. And the shaking intensity saturates at some point. So it's somewhat higher than the 2475, but it's not twice as high. Okay. For each one of those, we selected 15 earthquake ground motion records. And we worked with Paul Somerville in looking at these and making sure that things were reasonable and the way they might be done in practice. That's the bunch of plots on the right. 15 because it's better than 7, but we ran out of, we would have wanted to do 25 or 40, but time didn't permit. Each one of the building's designs was then handed to a different analysis team. There were some analyses that were done at Berkeley. There were some done at UC Irvine and some at UCLA. And I think some of the students are here, or former students are here today. But they did a tremendous amount of work analyzing each one of these systems in PERFORM and calculating the resulting expected responses. And here's some results for each of the 5 different hazard levels, each of the 15 different earthquake ground motion records in the east-west and in the north-south direction. These are the interstory drift ratios. And this was repeated 9 times for each of the 9 different building designs, so we had an array of response results. And the air conditioners were working full-time in the computation labs, I know. But we were very careful to make sure that consistent modeling and analysis techniques were being used each time. And what happened? What came out of it? And some of it's a little surprising and some of it isn't. First, we went to Davis Langdon to get estimates of what the costs would be by a professional. Okay, I didn't want to give this to my CE123 class and say, here, you know, see if you can get it. We went out and got some real numbers. And it's kind of interesting when you look across the different numbers what the costs were. One of the observations is that the structural system selection has a pretty significant impact on construction costs. And you, practicing engineers know this, but we found that, of course, here as well. The steel system was by a significant margin the more expensive. The dual system was more expensive than the core wall only system. Interestingly, doing the performance-based design didn't change the cost all that much, except in one case. But you know, if we look at the core wall system, it was 140 million, 140 million, 143 million, almost no difference in the result. The costs for the BRB actually came down because a lot of extra steel that was going into columns just to be there and wasn't really doing any work came out and the analysis wasn't required. It turned out with the dual system, the changes in the requirements for the framing system boosted the cost somewhat. So there was some increase in the cost for that system. Well, okay, this is the cost to build it. One of the things that PEER worked long and hard on and that really was adopted in the ATC 58 methodology is how do you look downstream and calculate what the downstream costs are going to be for you? So we did that exercise. And the conceptual idea, many of you have seen before, but I can do it in about 3 slides, maybe 4, is you take a ground motion, you subject your building to the motion, you look at a demand parameter like inner story drift, you define a performance group, a thing in the building, it could be a partition wall, and that thing can be damaged by that inner story drift. There are fragility relations that express the probability of being in a particular damaged state or worse as a function of that drift. Because you never know how the building was put together and exactly what quality of materials went into it, there's some uncertainty for a given drift ratio exactly what damage is going to happen. So you roll the wheel and you see where it falls in one example. So this one says, oh, you fall into damaged state Y3. Damage state Y3 requires that you go out and buy some wallboard and paint, and this is oversimplified, but this is the basic process involved in the calculation. And then there are costs, consequences associated with having to do this, and there's time down to do this and so forth. Now, this can be repeated many, many times. If you happen to have 15 earthquake records, which we had here, you can gather the statistics from the 15, and then you can use statistical techniques to generate as many as you want. And so you can do this for different hazard levels. You can integrate over the different annual frequency of exceedance or of occurrence, really, you want to get. And then you can find things like probabilities of being in a particular damage state or probability of different costs for different return periods. Okay, so we did this. This is the methodology kind of in 4 slides. And we did it for the tall buildings. And so for each one of them, we went back to Davis Langdon and we said, okay, let's find out what's in these buildings. Let's get all the stuff that matters. Let's find out what their fragility relations are. And we worked with ATC 58 and we used some of their fragilities and we gave them some new ones that were developed hand in hand with them. And then we went back to Davis Langdon, okay, what does it cost if you have to repair a shear wall like that? And they came back and they gave us the cost for those things. And again, some of those were available in ATC 58 and some weren't. And so ATC 58 got some free stuff and we did as well. This is what we modeled in the buildings. Structural, we looked at the shear walls, link beams, gravity columns, which means the slab column frames in the systems, and then moment joints, and then buckling restraint braces for the steel system. We looked at non-structural things as well, and contents, and we did the analysis. And I'm not going to bore you with the details, but we, from this kind of analysis, come out with loss results. And this is expressing on the horizontal axis a repair cost number, and on the vertical axis is the probability. So for example, the red curve, which is the 475 return period, the 50 percentile value, or the median value, comes out down here at about 12% of the initial cost of the building. Okay? A reasonable number, I think. So what other kinds of things can you get out of this methodology? Well, the method really is based on accumulating the results of many little pieces of damage. And so you can go back and you can disaggregate the damage. And you can start to understand what kinds of things are causing damage and which things aren't. And maybe that helps you adjust your design or think about how to change the whole framing system to reduce the damage. It was interesting, what was causing most of the damage in the concrete buildings was right here, something called GC. And it turns out GC is the gravity framing. So the slab column framing is where we calculated all the losses to be. And I don't know how many of you read Engineering News Record, but about 2 weeks ago there was an Engineering News Record article looking at exactly this thing and a problem with punching failures of slab column connections. We don't know how real the Engineering News Record problem is, but this is what we were calculating using the ATC 58 fragilities and losses. They're a big contributor in the loss of these buildings. Other things you might want to do, well, some of us are in the business of calculating probable maximum losses. Well, you know, this is a way you could get to that. You could take for the 500-year return period the red curve and go in at the 90 percentile and read down percentages. And so these are the different numbers that come out. So the core wall system is about 14, 15%. The dual system, a little bit less is what we calculate. The BRB is really low. And Simpson, Gumpert, and Hager designed the BRB, and Ron Hamburger loves to show this slide. We have to remind Ron that in the BRBs, we didn't include the effect of residual drift. And the BRBs have a fair bit of residual drift in them that we didn't include in this procedure. And then Ron says, well, yeah, there is that. You can also do some other kinds of calculations. And I'm a little nervous about this calculation. I kind of don't like it. But some of our clients who supported the research like this sort of a result. I'll show it to you so you can think about it. If you wanted to calculate your average annual loss, maybe that relates to what the insurance premium ought to be in some way. And so if you think about it, okay, if I have one of these buildings, maybe these are kind of where my insurance premiums ought to go. And so, again, you know, the BRB is going to be lower because we're not including the residual. But these are kinds of the numbers that you would get. And then it was also suggested, why don't you take these kinds of numbers and do some cost-benefit studies and see what you get. So we took the following. We said you got initial construction cost. You've got a net present value of these insurance premiums that you can calculate. You can take a time value of money. You know, I took 5 because I didn't want to commit myself to a more realistic number. And then you can normalize the results to what you get from the code-based design. And the answer disturbs me a little bit. It's 1. Quite interesting. And at first look, I thought, well, why am I getting 1 for all the numbers here? Basically, it's saying, you know, the performance-based design basically cost me in the end the same amount that the code-based design cost. Well, it's not surprising. If you design a building for occupancy category 2, code performance, you shouldn't be surprised if that's what you get. And that's kind of what we got out of these buildings. We didn't design them for especially high performance. We designed them to perform according to the code minimum performance expectations. And I think the surprising thing is that the code gave us something that was close to what the performance-based designs actually gave. The dual system actually went up a little bit because of the moment frame costs. Okay, some quick conclusions. And we've had enough words for one day, so some art. The conclusions, of course, are of, you have to understand there's a limited scope to what we did here. We looked at 9 buildings. We did it with computers. It's not real in that sense, but we did our best. One conclusion for tall buildings, no big surprises. And that's good news, because many of us worry about how are these tall buildings going to perform. By the best that we could do with the analysis tools available, there were no big surprises in these buildings. But these were very well-designed buildings. And in some buildings, I think we're going to have problems of wall shear and column axial force in moment frames, but in buildings not designed quite as well as these, because there are indicators from what we did that say the code design is playing with fire. The cost of the performance-based designs, generally it was negligible. It didn't really cost much more to have a performance-based design, except for the design fee. I think that went up. The benefits, as I mentioned before, you know, if you design for code equivalent performance for occupancy category 2, you shouldn't be surprised if that's what you get. And that's what we got here. So where to go from here? Lots of ways to go. Of course, the poster session is where we really want to go. But where from here? I think we could consider alternative performance objectives. You know, what if we designed for a higher performance? Would it cost us any more? And how much can we reap out of that design for a higher performance? Would we get it? Would we get something beneficial? We didn't really look at that. High performance systems or other alternative systems that use energy dissipating systems or alternative mechanisms is worth looking at. Existing tall buildings, you know, buildings designed in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, what are we looking at in our cities? And I think that's an important thing that maybe PBEE is already thinking about and planning on. And you know, these were tall buildings, and one of the expectations for tall buildings is that they're, you know, they're out in a period range. They're designed very efficiently to support their loads because all they are is structure. And so it's not so unusual that these performed well. How about more ordinary buildings? I wonder how those would fare if we ran through the same procedure. And I think the answers would be quite different. A closing note, 12 years ago, Bill Holmes challenged the PBEE Center to build a performance engine. You know, and he presented a now famous slide that says, look, let's forget about life safety and collapse prevention and so forth. He says, let's turn it into capital losses and downtime and casualties. And PBEE did it. And that tool is a very powerful tool. It's being used now for bridges and for geotechnical structures. We've looked at it for tall buildings. The ATC 58 methodology is here, and it's going to be available for engineers to use on a routine basis. It's a really powerful tool, and I think PBEE gets credit for a lot of it and should be proud of what it's done. And let's go forward and do more with this great tool now that we've got it. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Are there any questions? Yes, we have one question for you, Jack. Joe.
Okay, it's a great question. You're accusing us of performance-based earthquake engineering for the elite, I take it, and not for the ordinary people. And I suppose, you know, for a tall building like this, that's somewhat true. You're absolutely correct. Most of what's in here is perfectly applicable to an ordinary building, the routine buildings that we live and work in and that are not these elite kinds of buildings. And you know, there's really two answers for this. You know, one is, yes, I think we could take off, and Steve can take off the tall and modify this just a little bit, and it could be quite useful for other buildings as well, or it can be used as is by engineers who know what the key aspects are. The other thing, though, is that you know, we can take this methodology, I think, which is likely to only be used for the elites, you know, because it costs money to do this kind of work, and it takes time, and only those who have the money to do this performance-based design. It's not free. You know, it's only going to be in special cases, you know, Pixar and so on, that are going to use this directly. But these techniques can be used to tune up our building codes and to improve regular practice. And I think that's where we're going to have the biggest impact on buildings for everybody. And so I think it's a great question, and we can talk more at the poster session about it.
Thank you. Other question? Well, I'd like to thank Jack for a very good presentation. Clearly, we're interested in all types of structures, buildings, bridges, offshore platforms, high-speed rail systems, and so on. I think Ross talked about three things that he thought of trying to move what we do in research into practice, of having something which is accessible, so we have some documentation. Making them tractable so that the equations have been put into a form that ordinary people can use them and to demonstrate utility. And either by getting discussion on something or being able to compare alternate one, alternate two, and alternate three on an equal basis and saying that they achieve the same performance and they cost different, but that the present value of the cost is a wash. That's a useful insight in its own right, which if you maybe had a broader scope, you would be looking at tens of thousands of different kinds of buildings. So in any event, I think we have accomplished a lot today, which is culminated after lots of work by many people. Tomorrow, we're going to roll up our sleeves and get down to maybe some more in-depth discussions on some of these items, but more importantly, try to see what kinds of things could be done in the future and how you might be able to contribute to that. PEER is a funding agency in one level, but at another level, we have very little money. But what we have, in absence of money, we have a great deal of enthusiasm and intellectual resources. And by working together, as again Ross said, we're able to do things synergistically so that what we're able to do together is most likely far more than we're able to do individually. Speaking of which, there is a reception outside with some student posters, so I would encourage you to talk to the students. They're all very enthusiastic and energetic and are working on things that they're very passionate about. Tomorrow we will have a series of breakout sessions that starts at 9 o'clock. Go directly to the breakout rooms that are appropriate for the meetings that you're interested in. And so there's no kickoff plenary sessions. We will get back together for lunch in this room tomorrow, and there'll be some presentations so you get to see a little bit about what happened in each of the breakout sessions. And then we'll go back into some breakout sessions in the afternoon, and at the end of the day, there will be a plenary session to sort of bring everything together, hopefully. Again, there'll be food and light refreshments outside, but maybe not dinner. But there are many restaurants around the Bay Area, sort of the Berkeley gourmet ghetto nearby. So there's many restaurants you can go to and have dinner and continue our discussions. So thank you very much for today and your attention. And please go out and chat with the students. Thank you.
Carl. Yes. Yeah, I need to finalize the recording too.
Thank you.